السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من علم لا ينفع، ومن عين لا تدمع، ومن قلب لا يخشع، ومن نفس لا تشبع، ومن دعاء لا يسمع. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one who was sent to us in order to guide us to the straight path. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless him and all his companions, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless every single one of us and to grant us goodness. My brothers and sisters, it is indeed an honor to be here speaking about a man whom we are actually not fit to be speaking about, except by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is because it's our duty to convey the message that we feel so honored and privileged to be allowed for a moment to share that which has been given to us as a gift by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the very person of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah says, لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ يَتْلُو عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَإِن كَانُوا مِن قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. Indeed, Allah has favored the believers. Allah has bestowed favor upon the believers when He sent to them the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The biggest gift I have is the fact that I believe in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the message he came with. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the gift Allah has favored the believers when he sent to them a messenger from amongst them who recited the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That shows us that the most important thing he brought was the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah says, the gift was that he was sent to you reciting the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And cleansing in the sense purifying through an entire lifestyle. Removing people from darkness to light. Bringing people from that which was unacceptable to that which became known as an act of worship. That which was ignorance. As you know, they were in a period of ignorance, engaging in so much, both spiritually and religiously. In fact, even more than that, they were engaged in social misdeeds. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removed them from that darkness into the light. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed them all and blessed us as a result. The message came through all the way to us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is the messenger. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent him as a gift. What did he do? He recited the verses. He came through with an entire sunnah, his whole lifestyle. If Allah had wanted, he could have sent an angel with the message. But he chose to send a human being with the message. The best of creation, the best from amongst us, the highest and most noble of all the messengers. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon them all. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a man with the message in order to live the entire message so that we can follow him. If it was just an angel that had come down, perhaps we might say that it's impossible to follow these because they are angels. It is impossible to follow an angel because we are from a different species altogether. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed us by sending us one from amongst us, subhanallah. Although the highest from amongst us, but definitely chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for us. So consider it a blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Consider it a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you have this beautiful example. Even though some time back people were astray. وَإِن كَانُوا مِن قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. Even though before they were in manifest error or they were astray in a clear way, subhanAllah. Do we not see the light? Well, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent forth to us a messenger and we still remain in the darkness, that's impossible. We should never ever be from amongst those who remain in the darkness when there is a great gift right in our midst that is given to us. We have the Qur'an, it is recited to us. We have it in our midst and it is the gift for us. How can we then be from amongst those who are misguided? The source of guidance is the message that was brought by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have it. So therefore, the misguidance that is in the lives of people should be eradicated through the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The problem is, we become lazy to go through the message and we become lazy to study the message of that messenger and his entire lifestyle and his ways. In the next few moments, I want to speak about the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's a term that we use so often. This is the sunnah. Sunnah. What is the meaning of the term sunnah? Linguistically, it is the path and the way. Any way and path. Any example set by a person linguistically would be known by or as sunnah. So, from a linguistic point of view, it can be a good path and it can be a bad path. For example, we have the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wherein he says, "Man sanna sunnatan hasanatan." And in the same narration he says, "Waman sanna sunnatan sayyi'atan." This is from a linguistic point of view where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is giving an example and he says, "Whoever from amongst you sets a good example, you have a good way that people are following, you will get a full reward for anyone who follows that way and that path up to the day of judgment without a decrease in the reward. But if you were to set a bad sunnah, which means you are to set a bad example, then you will have a sin for that bad example that you have set, and anyone who follows it thereafter, the sin will continue multiplying for the initial person and for all those who were responsible to pass it on up to the day of judgment without a decrease in the sin. Now that is a very serious narration because it shows us that whatever example we lay in our lives, when it is followed, the result of that we will be receiving in full, whether good or bad. So let us go out of our way to ensure that the examples we set in our own lives are not bad examples, but rather they are good examples. So this is the linguistic meaning of the term sunnah. When it comes to the Shari'i explanation or the Islamic explanation of the term sunnah, we are referring to the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in general. The way, his lifestyle, his speech, his utterances, his characteristics, both his character and his characteristics, the physical appearance is also included in the term sunnah when we speak about it from that point of view. And this is why, if we take a look at the deeper meaning of the term sunnah, in the different departments or in the different disciplines within the Islamic explanation, we would find that at times it is used to refer to that which is not an innovation. What this means is, sometimes I would say, my brother, you are following the sunnah, so do not engage in bid'ah. I'm sure you may have heard that term. What it would mean is, and this is something we need to really ponder deeply over, it means the messenger was sent with the purpose of teaching us how to worship Allah. So if you are following his way of worshipping Allah, you are following the sunnah. And if you are following another way of worshipping Allah, you are following the bid'ah. That is what is meant by it. And this is why, if we understand the whole purpose of sending Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to us, we would come to realize that particular meaning of the term sunnah. He was sent to us in order to show us how our Maker wants to be worshipped. So the Maker decided, this is permissible, this is prohibited. Where did I learn that from? There was a messenger whom he sent to me and to you, telling us, this is permissible, this is prohibited. So in the same way that I will understand what is permissible and prohibited from the Maker himself, through that messenger, I will also understand what type of worship is permissible or prohibited through the same messenger, and that was sent by the same Maker. Amazing. And if I am not to do that, or if I discount what the messenger has said, it means I am not following the sunnah. And this is why the verses we heard a few moments ago, Allah says, قُلْ أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ فَإِن تَوَلَّوْا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْكَافِرِينَ. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell them, follow Allah and follow His Messenger. And if you turn away, Allah does not like those who disbelieve. That's a very serious verse. That actually means that if you turn away from following Allah and His Messenger, or if you want to follow whether it is an increase or a decrease in it, then Allah says He doesn't like those who have disbelieved in the core of the reason of sending Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to you and I. That means we have insulted the messenger by not acknowledging that he was sent to us with a specific mission. What was his mission? To show us the complete way. And it was completed. We've heard in the Qur'an, and I'm sure we are well aware, and we know and we understand that the deen has been complete. We say it so many times, and we read it in the verses where Allah says, إِنَّ الدِّينَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الْإِسْلَامِ. The religion that is acceptable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the only faith, is submission. To submit to what? To the message that Allah says, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا. The same deen has been explained by Allah saying, this day I have perfected your religion, I have perfected your deen, I have completed my favor upon you. What is the favor of Allah? On one hand, Allah is saying, my favor to you is that I sent to you a messenger from amongst you. And on the other hand, He is saying, I have completed my favor unto you, meaning the message is now complete. Take it or leave it. It's up to you. If you take it, you will win. If you leave it, you have lost. A person who wants to become a doctor, and they have a place at the university to study medicine, and they decide to dilly-dally outside the university, who is to blame? When they will spend 50 years, even 50 years, but outside the gates of the university, will they become a doctor? The answer is no. So the thing with us, if we keep on calling ourselves Muslimin who want to go to Jannah, but we don't enter that university that will teach us how to get to Jannah, how do we expect to graduate? Allahu Akbar. It's important for us to learn this and to understand the gift of Allah upon us. Really, what will happen is we will become human beings to start with, who understand their Maker, their purpose in life. What is the difference between those who believe and those who disbelieve? In this verse I read a few moments ago, Allah says He does not like those who disbelieve. Those who do not acknowledge that they have a Maker that they owe worship to. I owe worship to someone, to some supreme deity who made me. Definitely I have to worship Him. Because wherever I was before I was born, and wherever I am going to go to after I die, I know there is a place. But with my small mind, I cannot guarantee you exactly where we are going. I need the help of the same Maker to answer you or to answer myself. And for that, he has sent a messenger. And that is the only proper answer that we have. The others have all just beaten about the bush from left to right, trying to explain what is going on. Nobody has come up with a good explanation. And this is why Allah says, those intellectuals of Quraysh who had known how to read and write, when they said, مَا هِيَ إِلَّا حَيَاتُنَا الدُّنْيَا نَمُوتُ وَنَحْيَا وَمَا نَحْنُ بِمَبْعُوثِينَ. In another place, وَمَا يُهْلِكُنَا إِلَّا الدَّهْرُ. They used to say, it is only this life of the dunya, so enjoy it as it is. It is only this life. We are alive and we shall die. There is nothing else that is going to happen. So therefore, enjoy as and when you wish. It is only time that kills us. And when we are dead, there is nothing happening. So don't worry. And this is up to this day, we find people uttering the same statement. So much so that we have people who look at a tree and they say, this was my grandfather a few hundred years ago. I've come across that. We were under the tree once, a few years ago, and there was a person who told me that they had passed in the same place some time back, and one person told that person that this tree was their grandfather or great-grandfather, one of their ancestral trees. Subhanallah. If that is the type of confusion that people have created in the minds of people to the degree that some people begin to believe that, believe me, we are confused totally. Yet we have the torch right with us. We have the torch with us. And that is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire lifestyle. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created the best of us and made him the highest of us. And at the same time, all we need to do is just follow. Follow the leader. You don't know the path from here to the airport? Well, you know what? Follow the one who knows it. And you will get to the airport. Subhanallah. Amazing. As simple as that. And they are getting to the same place. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where will we see him? We will see him in paradise. May Allah grant us that. Ameen. But to get to that paradise, we need to follow that path that he used to get there, so we can also use to get to the same place. And this is why sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look at him, look at his character, look at the way he spoke. This is all part of the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When the historians speak of the term sunnah, they are actually referring to his history, complete history of his. And when the muhaddithin who have written down the hadith refer to the term sunnah, they are speaking of all his utterances and all his confirmations and all his words and agreements and every movement of his, they have recorded in what is known as the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So have we made an effort to study any of these meanings of the term sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Have you gone out to look at hadith? Have you understood that people can actually create hadith just in order to lie to you and I, in order to get you and I to do things that are not part of the sunnah? Now, I want to pause for a moment. One might ask, why would people lie to us that this is a hadith when it is not a hadith? Meaning, this is a saying of the Prophet when it is not a saying of the Prophet. One of the reasons is because they know the seriousness of ourselves to following the words of the messenger. So in their desperation for us to follow them rather than the messenger, they create words and they say, this is part of what the messenger said, so that you and I start doing it, thinking that it's the statement of the messenger. Had we known it was the statement of someone else, it would have held no value. Allahu Akbar. Or very little value. This is why people lie. But Allah has blessed us as an ummah by protecting not only the Qur'an, but even the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How did he protect the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? There is something amazing and unique that has happened. Something that has not happened with the life of anyone else before or after. What is it? Every movement of his, every characteristic of his, every statement of his has been recorded, not just recorded, but anyone who recorded it, they have a chain of narrators, of honest and upright people going all the way back to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself. So pick up a book of hadith. And if it is one of the major books of hadith, you will always find, say for example, al-Bukhari, which is one of the most powerful books after the Qur'an, you find those hadith in there, muttafaqun alayh, that are agreed upon between the two imams, Imam Muslim and Imam Muhammad ibn Ismail al-Bukhari, rahmatullahi alayhim, may Allah's mercy be upon them. If you find the hadith is agreed upon both of them, those are the most powerful narrations in terms of the strength of the chain, of people who carried the statement to us, which leaves no doubt in our minds that there definitely was a statement of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam exactly like this. Or this was part and parcel of the sunnah. Why? Because you will find in their books, they don't just say the messenger said this and that. Today if I'm talking to you, I might say the messenger has said this and that. Because if I were to go into the details of the chains of narrators, perhaps just one hadith would take up the whole hour that we have. So rather, I say this, but I am responsible and so are you. If you hear anything that you are doubting even in the least, it's up to you to go back and check the chain of narrators. Nowadays, it's quite easy because we have technology that has helped us to look into it. Still, we are lazy. You want to know what is a fabricated narration? There will be simple books that will tell you fabricated narrations. And they'll explain to you this man and they give you a name. Muhammad ibn Sa'ib al-Kalbi, for example. They might tell you, this name, this person used to actually fabricate. Sometimes people fabricate to become famous. They will tell you, do you know what? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said this, and they come up with something that they have said. You see, we have, for example, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, one of the most powerful of the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one of those who is also going to be in paradise. He was informed already, one of the ashara, one of the ten, and he was the fourth of the khulafa, one of the most powerful people. He was a young boy when he accepted the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sometimes when people hear a good statement, they quickly add to the end of it, narrated by Ali radiallahu anhu. Narrated by Ali radiallahu anhu. And one day, 2 or 3 years ago, when I came across this, I looked at it and I said, but this is a saying of Mark Twain. Mark Twain, really? And they just put Ali. So I sent a message to the one who messaged me, why did you just put the name of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu? He said, I don't know, I got the message from someone else. And they sent it back to the person until we sent it to about 4 or 5 people. And it happened to be a person who said, you know what? We love Ali radiallahu anhu so much that anything good, we just say it is reported by Ali because he was a gift of Allah to us. So I said, yes, he was a gift of Allah to us. But that does not mean we should lie. The same applies to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was the gift of Allah to us. But don't lie about what he has said. Because we will be doing a disservice to Allah. It is a path to paradise that we are playing with, my brothers and sisters. And we cannot risk that. Because we have one chance. Just one. And that is whilst you are alive. I'm going to go to paradise. We continue saying, may Allah forgive our shortcomings, my brothers and sisters, say Ameen. May Allah forgive our shortcomings and grant us paradise. So, it is one life that we've been given and one chance, and this chance is prolonged many years in a lot of our cases. But we don't know when the chance is over. We don't know when the examination is over. But so we should not lie and we should be able to recognize a lie. Allahu Akbar. If you were to go back to the books of fabricated narrations, they will tell you in the introduction that people fabricated for several reasons. 1, 2, 3, and they mention the reasons. One of them, like I said, to become famous. The other is, in order for you to take serious a statement that is not so serious. This is something amazing. For you to take serious a statement that is not so serious. And sometimes it's just people who really could not be bothered. They perhaps do not want you to be a good believer. They perhaps do not want you to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the correct manner. So they just come and add things. They add things, subhanallah. Like, you know, we have read narrations where, and I'm sure you are aware of the fact, that there are four imams of fiqh. We have Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi, Malik ibn Anas rahmatullahi alayhi, Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayhi, and Ahmad ibn Hanbal al-Shaybani rahmatullahi alayhi. So we have these four who have worked very hard. They have actually set forth schools of jurisprudence, and we know that, and we acknowledge that. So some of the followers who want to drift in order to prove that we are better than you, they came up with fabricated narrations that Muhammad ibn, for example, Idris al-Shafi'i, and this is something that people have said, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that there will come a time, a man known as Muhammad ibn Idris will come about, he will be worse than Iblis. As soon as you hear that, you know it's a lie. You discount it, you throw it, and you kick it out. Why? Because that is a total fabrication. And if we cannot recognize such basics, then believe me, we have not understood the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what it is all about. His ahadith were never like that. He never spoke in that way. He did not curse, nor did he swear, no. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. So in order to promote your madhab, for example, you cannot come up with something derogatory about the other madhab and claim that it's a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But more foolish than that is when a person says that, you know what, it is a narration. That's why I belong to this madhab. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. This is why we say, if you want success, you need to understand at least the basics of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his message, and the messenger that was sent with that particular message. So here we have Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What a powerful example. What a beautiful example. But his character and conduct is part of that sunnah. Don't make a mistake to think it is not a part of it. So if you are not humble, you cannot be a good Muslim. You have not followed the path. If you do not have good character and conduct, you do not know how to treat those who do not like you. People who don't like you, they don't like, today they say, I don't like your face. You know, once I was sitting in a restaurant, funny, and I heard someone tell the other person, shut up your face. And I started laughing because I don't know how to shut up somebody's face. Maybe shut your mouth might have been a little bit, okay, it's a bit harsh, but it might have been understandable. But to shut up your face, Allahu Akbar. And I thought to myself, we are Muslims, we would not say that. Does anyone from amongst us say that? If we do, where is the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Where is your path to paradise? How do you want to speak to people? Be careful, because Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never ever spoke to people like that. Even his arch enemies, they were never addressed in that way. Not even. So remember, those who oppose you, those who don't like you, those who think derogatory about you, those who really want you to shut up your face, you don't have to want it for them. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. I'm sorry to give you that example. It came to my mind and it is such a pertinent example. The way we address each other, the way we talk to each other. Sometimes our own children, we use words of animals to address our own children. Is that okay? And you want to be a Muslim on the sunnah, so you have your hijab on and you have your beautiful dress code on, but you're calling your child an animal, can you know something? It is only an animal that gives birth to an animal. Allahu Akbar. So in a nutshell, when you say, astaghfirullah, I don't even want to say the word, but when you call your child an animal, but mom, you gave birth to me. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not do that to us. This is the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to address your children with utmost respect. Ask yourself, do I do that? So when we speak of the sunnah, there are so many aspects of it. All the aspects are serious. Some of them we take a little bit lighter, but some of them are extremely serious. When it comes to matters of belief, when it comes to matters of the deen, when it comes to the way you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you need to know that these are the most serious portions of the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But never discount the character and conduct and the entire lifestyle. Even his dress code, he has prohibited us from dressing with clothing of arrogance. To clothe yourself with the clothing of arrogance. He says, no, you're not supposed to do that. And this is where the issue of showing the ankle comes about. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to wear that clothing which does not depict and display haughtiness and arrogance, to say, you know what, I'm higher than everybody. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to be from amongst those who understand the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So my brothers and sisters, what a gift of Allah when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we sent to you a man so that you can follow him, so that you can follow that example. And this is why in Surah Al-Ahzab, the famous verse that I'm sure we should be knowing by now, Allah says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. Indeed, for you in the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or in the very person of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is a powerful example to emulate for the one, subhanallah, who is looking forward to the meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for the one who is looking forward to the last day. And for the one who remembers Allah often, a lot. You remember Allah, you will remember His gift upon you. And you will go through the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Be careful of people who try to con us. I can give you one more example of the conings. Sometimes you have people who want you to follow something that is absolutely incorrect. So they have compiled entire books and they just say, this man met Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his dream, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him a hadith that nobody knew. Nobody knew. Okay, for a moment, one might think that, you see, we believe that if you dream of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the characteristics that are described in his description within the hadith are the same, then he is definitely the person you have seen in your dream. So what is the condition? When you dream of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let's talk of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you dream of him, there is one condition only. And that condition is the characteristics that are mentioned of his in the books of hadith and seerah and of his lifestyle. If you see him upon those characteristics, then it was definitely him. And if you see him upon other characteristics, then the hadith says, Shaytan cannot imitate Muhammad in the dream of people. Shaytan cannot imitate Muhammad, may peace be upon him, in the dreams of people. But Shaytan can lie to someone that he who is not Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So there is a subtle difference between the two, which we need to know. You dream of the messenger, it was definitely him. But if you see someone in a Levi's jeans with a cigarette and, you know, music, or, you know, blasting, and they bouncing around, and you ask, who are you? He says, I am Muhammad, the messenger, peace be upon him. You must know, Shaytan did not imitate him, but it's clear cut that Shaytan is lying to you, that someone who's not the messenger is the messenger. So this is the only condition that there is regarding this particular dream. However, even if you have dreamt of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you need to know something. The Qur'an says, the verse that I read moments ago, that we have perfected your faith, your religion is complete, totally. No addition, no subtraction, up to the last day. And therefore, if someone comes about saying, we saw a dream and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam told me that there is one narration I need you to relay to the people, you must know immediately as a Muslim that that is a lie. No matter how pious the person seems, it is a lie. It is a blatant insult to the greatest of creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a blatant insult, because if that was the case, it means all the verses that prove that the message is complete are false. Because there was one thing left which was quickly given to someone in his dream. How can that be? Remember this. We should never be conned and confused. And this is why you open some of the books and they tell you, we have imams whom you are not allowed to question. When they tell you Muhammad said this sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you must know that he visits them regularly and he gives them the hadith. You know, we are not living in Disneyland here. Really. We are not living a fairy tale. Believe me, this is the real life. It is the real life. And we are responsible. Allah's blessed us with a brain. Use it. There's nothing supernatural that's suddenly going to happen here. Yes, there are miracles that do occur, but not of this nature, whereby a hadith was missing, so suddenly we found it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Let's not insult the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So if you look at the sunnah from that aspect, my brothers and sisters, it is your duty and mine to protect the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is why we are Muslimin. When your child is affected by something, or your child is so dear to you that you would not like to see any form of harm on your child. If they were to go to school, for example, and they come back from the school and tell you, you know what, somebody is troubling me at the school, what will you do as someone who loves your child? At the minimum is, you will contact the teacher. If the teacher doesn't do something about it, you will contact the head. And you will say, listen, there is a problem, my child is complaining, please can you look into it? Subhanallah. As much as you know, children can sometimes tell you a lie, don't just believe kids. You know, children, when they are wrong, they can quickly come to you and in advance tell you that someone else did something to them, yet they were the ones who started it. And you as a parent rolls up your sleeves and you go and beat up. I was going to say beat up, let's not say beat up, because we shouldn't be doing that. But you go and admonish somebody else's child, thinking that your child was right, and your child is so happy, yes, my mother did it for me, my father went and shouted and scolded, not realizing that your child was the one who was wrong. So when they investigate and come back to you, do you know what? Your child was wrong. Many of us would not even want to accept the truth. When it comes to the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the reason why I gave you that example is, we should be loving him more than our own children, so we should be insulted when people have tried to contaminate his words and his narrations. Let me give you one way that people are fighting the sunnah. One way. Can I tell you? It is that people are now saying, the sunnah was recorded more than a century after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What value does it have? It's a question. That's what they say. It sounds like, wow, yeah, that's right. Why did they take 100 years to start recording the hadith? Why didn't they do it quickly? So you and I need to know the answers. And there is a simple logical answer. Today we are living in a technologically advanced stage. While I'm speaking, there are thousands of people who are watching perhaps this particular talk online. And there will be another few thousand who will see it later on. And it will be remaining. If anyone wants to say, I said this and I said that, it's quite easy to watch the entire clip. You know, be careful of the cut and paste chefs. You know what they do? When they don't like you, they just cut and paste a little portion of what you said, and they say, this man is very bad, because look what he said. And then they show the person speaking, and he has said something, but they did not show you the full sentence, or they did not show you the whole talk. They only show you a snippet of it to fool you. That is the new way of fooling us. It happens to a lot of people. So don't just believe things you see. Go back, see the entire clip. Go and see what's happening. See the whole speech. Go and listen to it from A to Z. Is it true? Is it correct? And if that really is the case, then you sit and consider, contemplate, and you be the judge by the will of Allah for yourself. Meaning to know whether or not to be able to take your deen from someone, you need to know their credentials. But don't just believe the swipings of people. Sometimes it's the devil that makes people swipe at others, and we don't understand we are entrapped by the same devil. So today we are in a technologically advanced age, mashallah. It's quick to say that, you know, while I'm talking, my telephone is actually recording it in written form, typed out completely. By the time I've completed the talk, I can have a written version of the entire talk and give it to you. There will be very few mistakes, perhaps if my accent is not so clear, or some of the words that have come out of my mouth could have been mixed up, very few words. But then we can quickly look through it very easily and continue. This is voice recognition. We know about it, technologically advanced. Let's go back to the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because we want to answer the question that people are asking: why was hadith recorded more than a century after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam? The bulk of the books were recorded later on. To be honest, it's a good question, but there is a proper answer for it. Proper. There was no internet at the time. There were no computers at the time. To be honest, there were no books at the time. Did you ever think of that? They did not use to read and write. Go back to the verse. Allah says, هُوَ الَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ. It is Allah who sent in the midst of the unlettered a messenger from amongst them. Which means most of the people were unlettered. They could not read or write. But they had a memory that was so powerful. They knew the lineage of their camels 7 generations back. We don't even know our own lineage 7 generations back. If I were to tell anyone in this hall, I'm so tempted to do it. Does anyone from amongst you, is anyone from amongst you able to recite your entire lineage now off by heart, going back to 7 forefathers? Please put up your hand. I do not see a single hand. Please stand up in case I'm missing your hand. So they had a memory that was probably one of the best. And they relied on the memory. And this is why when the Qur'an came down, they immediately recited it. The little children knew the surah of Tabbat Yada Abi Lahabin wa Tabba, yet they were not Muslimin, the little kids at the time. And it was something from Allah, but they were gifted not only to memorize and remember things, they knew long passages. As soon as a passage was revealed, to this date or to this day, those who do not contaminate themselves with the new mobile phones and the new technology memorize many more phone numbers than those who have. It includes myself and yourselves. Wallahi, without a joke, I think maybe 15 years ago, I must have known 1,000 phone numbers. They used to call me the telephone operator in my own house. Because anyone's number, wallahi, without a joke, anyone's number you wanted to know, they would call me, say, what's this uncle's number? I would tell you, 471-7866, subhanAllah. And they would say, oh, this one is the operator. Here's my operator. Wallahi, that was one of the names they had given me when I was young in my own home. I'm talking of my siblings. They must be laughing watching me right now. The reality is, we knew the numbers, so many. Today, I don't think I know more than 10 numbers. To be honest with you, the number I'm using right now, I have no clue what it is. No clue. So you know that when there is a will, or where there is a will, there is a way. You know that. When you have to do something, you have to do it. This is why sometimes I say, brother, what's your number? And he says, are you writing it down? And sometimes I say, no, I'm just memorizing it. If the person is extremely important, believe me, you're going to memorize that number. You will know it. I know, I spoke to some of the youth. They say, yeah, I know my girlfriend's number. What? Yeah. I hope you heard what I said. Allahu Akbar. Why? Because to them, that's VIP. Forget about the double V that we have today. No. Oh, I'll never ever get the chance. You know, to know this again. I've just got this number. Allahu Akbar. Let's get a little bit serious. Going back to what we were saying, my brothers and sisters. At the time, they loved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so much that the way he breathed, they tried to breathe in the same way. Can I give you one example? Sahaba radiallahu anhum were such that some of them used to stop going from Makkah to Medina at the same position that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stopped to take a little rest and relieve himself. And they used to take a little rest and relieve themselves. And when they were asked, why are you stopping exactly here? They said, because we witnessed the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stopping here. That was love. Now people say, oh, that's fanatical. Well, to be honest with you, when people cut their hair like the football players, then it's not fanatical. When people dress like the others who are singing and dancing across the globe, then it's not fanatical. And when people want to follow a messenger, then it becomes fanatical. Allahu Akbar, what is this? These are double standards. No one is imposing it on anyone, but it's your own choice. This is the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The reason why I know exactly where he stopped between Makkah and Medina Munawwara is because the people loved him so much that they continued stopping in a similar place. Allahu Akbar. It's not compulsory to stop there, but when you love someone and you want to stop there, nobody can tell you it's wrong. You know what? I was in Makkah just a few weeks ago, and we went from Makkah to Medina. And this time there is an al-bayt that you can stop at. Believe me. Anyone who's been there, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Between Makkah and Medina, there's a beautiful, beautiful, very, very, you know, tasty food at that restaurant, lovely restaurant known as al-bayt. Al-bayt, you know, let me give you a little joke. A friend of mine went from Zimbabwe to Saudi Arabia. So he started asking some time back, saying, you know what, do you know any good places to eat? So someone told him, you must go to al-bayt. So he said, wow, okay, I'll remember that. So when he went, he actually caught a taxi. And he tells the taxi, I want to go to al-bayt. I want to go to al-bayt. And to be honest with you, this is a true story. The taxi driver is confused. Al-bayt, you're not even in ihram. Al-bayt, what is al-bayt? He says, no, food, food. So the taxi, oh, you mean al-bayt. Okay, okay, we know where to take you. Allahu Akbar. That is how serious the place is. People stop there, they go there. You know, people go to Makkah sometimes and they say, I'll go, I'll make my umrah, but I'll eat there as well. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. The reason why I make mention of this, the way Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ate and what he ate is all inspired by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Go back to look at the food, the way he ate, how much he ate. He never ever filled his belly, not at all, not even once. He always had, and he taught us that even if you have food, make sure it is healthy. Look at what he ate. Take a look at his food, how it was made and cooked. Take a look at the value of the dates and the iron content in it. Go and take a look at the fruits that were eaten by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and if not eaten by him, then spoken about by him. And you will be amazed and shocked at how they will cure sicknesses that you and I have today. That is part of the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So if a person, for example, is ready to follow the full lifestyle of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they will lead a life full of happiness, full of health, full of goodness. He never filled his belly, as I said. فَإِنْ كَانَ لَا بُدَّ فَثُلُثٌ لِلطَّعَامِ وَثُلُثٌ لِلشَّرَابِ وَثُلُثٌ لِلنَّفَسِ. He says, if you really would like to eat, then ensure the maximum you get to, one third of solid, one third of liquid, and one third empty. So when you get up from your meal, you still have a capacity of one third of air. I don't know if I do that. Allahu Akbar. I'm just being honest. I don't even know if any one of us can do it. Especially when you're looking at your roast lamb. MashaAllah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. May He grant us peace. So, they say, so why didn't this hadith be recorded from day one? Well, do you know what? They were unable to read or write. What they wrote were verses of the Qur'an, because that was much more important. The word of Allah, you're not allowed to change the wording at all. when it comes to the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you should remain as accurate as you can with the wording. But if there is a slight difference in the wording that has not changed the detailed meaning, you will still be let to go. You will still be let to pass because the meaning did not change. With the Qur'an, you cannot do that. If the wa has become a fa, there is a mistake. So this is why Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at one stage told them, do not write down my utterances, because what was important was actually to write down the revelation of Allah, so the two are not mixed. So they knew immediately that this we will record. You know, they recorded it on little skins and different little pieces of wood and pieces of stone and slate and so on at the time. They did not have the paper we have today, subhanallah. So as they recorded it, they were known as Kuttab al-Wahi. The people, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, who were the writers of revelation. They wrote that revelation in a beautiful way. When it came to the hadith, they memorized it. People would go to one another and say, what did Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say regarding this particular issue? And so they would say, go to that man, he has a hadith. They would not just answer it themselves, which means he heard the statement. So they would go to, for example, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, and he would say, inni sami'tu Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yaqul, I heard the messenger say this. I heard the messenger say this. And so it was recorded in the minds of the people, because they knew. Then they would say, I heard Ibn Abbas say that he heard the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say this. And when it came to the next generation, it was already written down. Subhanallah. Now it was written. Now you tell me, 100 years later, they found the need to write it down because the memory started becoming slightly weaker. In order to record it before the memories become weak, they had to write it down at that stage at least. Today, it is like me telling you, I don't want to accept the hadith. Astaghfirullah, may Allah protect us. It is like someone saying, I don't want to accept the hadith because it's not on the internet. Why did it take them so long to put it on the net? Foolish man, there was no internet at the time. Simple. Why was it not typed in book form? There was no typewriter even at the time. Forget about keyboard. Allahu Akbar. So this is the thing. When you say, why wasn't it written? The technology at the time was memory. Let's call it technology. The technology at the time was not writing down. Writing down was something for the elite only. Those who knew how to read and write, they were very few. So even if you wrote it, big deal, no one was going to read it because they couldn't read. You know, it's like coming up with a big message in code form, the binary form, 0111000111, you know, that binary form, and very few people can understand your programming and what you've done. Very few. Why? Because it requires a study for 10 years before you can understand the first sentence in that type of a language. Amazing. So it's simple logical things like these, but because we have not thought about it, and we did not ask those with knowledge for answers, we sometimes think, yeah, that's right. How can we accept hadith? It was written 150 years after the messenger. There must have been contamination between that time. There must have been. And that's why there are so big disputes. The disputes are not really there, to be honest with you. If only you are ready to educate yourself, you'll find the disputes are not really there. There is education. It's easy, very easy to tell what is a fabricated narration, what is not. But it's not easy to digest your findings. Remember this. It's very easy to tell. Today, really, you can click any hadith even on the net. And you have websites that are reliable, that have specialized in the hadith, that you would know the source of, that these are the knowledgeable people, and you check the hadith, and it says, this hadith is fabricated because of this reason, and they give you all the reasons. They say, this man says he heard from that man, but to be honest, he died before the other was born. And you immediately know, oh, there's something wrong here. But to digest the content being wrong is something else. And sometimes the content can be correct, but the chain is broken because there is a more correct chain with the same content elsewhere. Let me give you an example. You know, the most powerful hadith that a lot of the muhaddithin, the scholars of hadith, have actually started their books by, is the hadith of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, where he says, I heard the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. I'm sure a lot of us would know that. Indeed, all actions are judged based upon their underlying intentions. That's the rough meaning of what he said. So, if someone says, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu has said this, we believe that and we know he did say it. But if someone says, for example, that Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu said, and they come about with the same hadith, it could be a mistake that Abu Huraira said it, but the hadith is correct. Which means, the statement is right, but the mistake they've made is they've uttered the wrong name of the narrator. So someone might say this is fabricated. When they say it's fabricated, what do they mean? It's either the chain being fabricated, or the content fabricated, or both of them fabricated. We need to know this. These are disciplines of hadith. And this is where our responsibility comes in. Protect the sunnah. Like I said, you love your child. Anything that anyone is trying to do to that child in order to degrade them or to defame them or to drop their respect or value, you would definitely do something about it because it's your child. This is something more important, someone far more valuable than anyone in our lives. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the minimum we can do to protect the dignity of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to safeguard his sunnah. To safeguard it in what way? Learn it, understand it, protect it from increase or decrease. And that is very, very important. It's not so difficult. We're just lazy. It's not difficult. We're just lazy. Protect it from increase or decrease. Convey it to others after living by it. Live by it. And you find that will definitely increase us in all forms of goodness. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon us all. Amen. So my brothers and sisters, here we have the explanation of why it came about so many years later. Because as soon as writing became the in thing, it was written. When typing became the in thing, it was typed. When CDs became the in thing, CD-ROM, it was put onto CD-ROM. When CD-ROMs were outdated, you no longer find it on there. Now they have it on flash sticks. And after that, no longer flash stick, they've got it on iCloud as well. Really? If you don't know what iCloud is, your mind might be clouded. Allah. They've got it on so many different things. Bluetooth. I know when I smiled, I didn't have a single one that was blue. Subhanallah. But at the same time, they've got, as technology progressed, so did the deen, the recording of the deen. It did not change, but the platform upon which it is standing has become in time or in line with the times. So at all times, it was in line with the times. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. One last point I'd like to make mention of, extremely important. Sometimes we read a hadith and we think to ourselves, no man, this is not true. Yet, the chain is so powerful, we definitely would know that the statement has to be powerful if the chain is powerful. But because we haven't understood that at that particular time, there must have been certain norms. I give you an example. People argue and debate. And they say, Islam promotes marrying children. You see? Because Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam married Aisha radiallahu anha at the age of 6. When she was 6 years old. To be honest with you, and I want to take you back 100 years, maybe 50 years. In your own communities, didn't you used to fix up your little kids from when they were born? Let's be honest. I see people nodding. Does that mean you promote things? Does that mean you promote little kids getting married? Today, the culture may have changed, but it is in line with the permissibility of what the sunnah has come with. Nobody said you have to get your kids married at a certain age. The culture that we spoke about yesterday, remember one point, and that is, that culture which is acceptable in Islam, Islam is not spoken about. Sometimes people mature at different ages. Today, our children perhaps become taller than us at the age of 12 and 13. They are much taller than us. They are bigger than us. They are more burning. They look at you and you're going to say, yeah, okay, son, it's fine. Because you know, you cannot say anymore, I'll give you a beating. When you say, I'll... Before you say, give you, you already say, love you. Allahu Akbar. So, people at the time matured very quick, very fast. You know, today, and I was reading an article that was saying that the school life that we have been conscripted to actually wastes 25 years of our time. I was reading an article that says that the reason why the fathers who decided that you have to go to school for 25 years before you can say hello to the world have actually did that is to keep the young people away when they have the energy that is bubbling and bursting out. Keep them out, keep them away, keep them occupied in polite nothings. Allahu Akbar. That's just an article that I read. It's just an opinion. But what I learned from it is, at the time there were leaders who, 17 years old, they were leaders of the nations. Even go back to other books of history. Take a look at Alexander the Great. How old was he? He was a kid, to be honest with you. If that age had to come today, the whole world would cry foul. He was not even the age of majority. And he was ruling. Allahu Akbar. Today you cannot drive a car, let alone rule even your own home. Allahu Akbar. So it's got to do with the culture. Stop going in and digging things of that nature. If that entire society believed it was wrong and there was an outcry, it would have been considered wrong. So whatever we do in our society, that entire society considers taboo, if it is a cultural matter, remember it probably is something you are doing that is wrong. So today we would encourage people to get married at an age when they understand what marriage is all about, they are ready for it, and for example, they have arrived at that age where it would not be a waste of time to get them married, because even if a person is 16, a few years ago, they would say, no problem. In fact, in some rural areas and even in some cities across the globe, they say, no problem. Yet, some advanced countries are trying to push a law that says you cannot marry before the age of 21. Yet, the sexual activity begins at 9. Don't you agree? I was reading a book, in fact, not a book, but an article on the net regarding the United States of America. And they said, they gave a percentage of the amount of children that are sexually active from the age of 9. They say by 14, the bulk of them already have been through it. May Allah protect us. By the age of 14. Now you tell me, 9? Well, go back to the hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When he married Aisha at 6, he did not sleep with her. He did not even live in the same home as her. He waited for her to become mature until her father and her parents chose that, you know what, this is the right age. She's now mature enough to live with you. So she went to live at that age. Today, the same age when people are active. Yes, we know we consider it taboo because they are not yet ready for that. But they are doing it behind our backs, believe me. Someone messaged me just yesterday telling me my son, 7 years old, he's hooked onto pornography in a way that I don't understand. What can I do? Allahu Akbar. Well, that's the world for you. We call those who lived a pure life barbaric, and we are barbaric. We call ourselves pure. May Allah protect us. We protect the sunnah by this type of explanation. We protect the sunnah by saying and by teaching the purity in relationships. We don't need to be embarrassed as to what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. All we need is to be educated as to why things happened in that particular way and to understand how to explain to the world that, you know what, it does not mean we promote any form of this, you know, child marriages and so on. No, not at all. We don't promote that. But we do know that the age of maturity and majority is being pushed to a greater figure as the years are passing. In my country, we can drive at the age of 16. I don't know about your country. I think it might be 18. Did someone just say 12? Allahu Akbar. I wouldn't be surprised, because they are 12 years old people, children who know how to drive better than adults sometimes. And in other countries it's 21, and you want to drive a truck, well, you need to be 25 in some countries. Why is it? Whereas they can drive sometimes from the age of about 7 and 8, depending on how much they've driven behind the father's back. Allahu Akbar. Quietly they got the Porsche and they're going down the street. They don't know, they've come back, quietly opened the gate and put it back, snoring in their bed. When you get up in the morning, you're getting them up, not knowing they spent the night outside. Where did they go and how? Your Porsche. These are different ages, so it will continue changing. I'm just hoping and praying that a day doesn't come when the age of majority is 40. Allahu Akbar. And if that day comes, they'll probably think that we were barbaric. It changes with the changing of time. My beloved brothers and sisters, we've had a beautiful afternoon. Really. When I started off, I had a slight bit of a headache. In no time, mashallah, went away. By the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Really, I achieved so much of internal peace to see the beautiful brothers and sisters with the broad smiles, mashallah. You can feel the warmth of the heart. Wallahi, I declare, I love you for the sake of Allah. I may not know you. We may have a few differences. You might not have agreed with everything I've ever said in my life. I'm a human. But remember one thing, at least we've shared some goodness. At least we have shared some good message. And at least we know we are all heading in one direction. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to meet in Jannah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive our shortcomings. Believe me, I would have loved to greet every one of you. But you know, and I know, that that is not so possible. So forgive me and excuse me if you were to see me walking out without having actually paused for a greeting. It's not what my heart wants. But sometimes it's what the situation calls for. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all goodness. May Allah grant us every reason to smile. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have granted exception to this beautiful session that we've had. As I said, we have not done justice even to a little bit of the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But I chose today to speak only from one specific angle. And I hope in future we can speak from more angles. Because the sunnah is a whole lifetime which will take 20 other lifetimes to speak about. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept us all. And we really ask Allah to grant those who are on that particular flight that is still missing, may Allah protect them and grant them ease and goodness and return them to us miraculously. Ameen. It is wrong for me to close the session without making a dua for them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless their families, grant them sabr, grant them patience. And may Allah return their loved ones to them. They are our loved ones too. Remember that. They are our loved ones too. They are part and parcel of our families too. They are families in faith, families in humanity. We feel for them. We reach out to them. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really to grant us that miracle. Whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has done, He knows. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows exactly where they are. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect them, and He will keep them in a condition that He would like to keep them, bearing in mind He loves them more than I do, more than you do, more than the own family members do. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator in the first place. We cannot compete with Him, but we call out to Him for that miracle. Ya Allah, grant it to us. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah alhamdi. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.